Today's topic is on Northern Wei Dynasty, and this is a period, it's a very chaotic period that takes place sometime. I'll show you the timeline first, which takes place sometime after the Han Dynasty. Alright, if you look at this timeline chronological order, you have your Han Dynasty, breaks apart into your three kingdoms. Where you have your Wei Wushu. This period has inspired the writing of this famous novel called Romance of the Three Kingdoms. And after that, it was shortly unified under this period called the Western Jin. And the Western Jin emperors were not doing a very good job. They got chased out of their homeland. They escaped and set up a capital in the south. And at this point of time, the northern area is overrun by non-Chinese barbaric tribes. And they form their small kingdoms. And we call this the Eastern Jing and 16 kingdoms. Dong Jing Siliu Guo. And after that, you have your northern and southern dynasties. In the sense that Eastern Jing is overtaken. And a new kingdom is established in the south. Here we see a distinctive feature where China is split into two halves, North and South, and we call it the Northern and Southern Dynasty. So today's talk is about this period. I'm going to talk about Northern and Southern Dynasty, in particular of just one specific kingdom, and this is the Northern Wei Kingdom. In Chinese, we call it the Fei Wei. Some of you might be confused, why is there Wei appearing all over the place in China history? If you look at Three Kingdoms, there's also a Wei. If you look at your Warring States, there's also a Wei in your spring and autumn period. The name of the state Wei is not tied to a particular timeline. In fact, it is more related to where this area is. So for the Northern Wei case, these people, they established a kingdom around this area which used to be Wei during the spring and autumn period. So they call themselves Wei. But for historians, easier reference, they call it Northern Wei. Okay, during those times, I do not think they will call themselves Wei Wei, but they just call themselves Wei. Even for Cao Cao, he doesn't call his country or his state Cao Wei, he calls it Wei. But it's for our studies to make it easier to differentiate that we add on this term. So Fei Wei refers only in particular to the Northern and Southern Dynasty. You will see Wei appearing over and over again in China history, but it refers to a different state in a different timeline. Okay? So this is the demarcation. This is the whole of China. And this is where Northern Wei is, Fei Wei. This is just a very rough demarcation, okay? It's not very clear, but it's along these lines, but this is just an estimation. This is just to show you that China is divided into two halves, okay? North and the South. So generally speaking, the North, the rulers in the North are non-Chinese. This applies also to the Northern Wei. The rulers of Northern Wei, they are not of Han Chinese. They are of a different race. And as for the South, here, mostly the rulers are Han Chinese. So this is the distinction between the two states. Fei Wei comes about. Even though I say that the Northern Wei period, sorry, the Northern and Southern Dynasty period, the North is ruled by the non-Chinese, there's something particular about this group of non-Chinese. So before Northern Wei's time, during the Eastern Jin and 16 Kingdoms time, these non-Chinese rulers have already been staying in proper China for some time. So what is very different about them is that they are semi-Chinese. In other words, they have many generations been living in China that they have adopted some of the Chinese culture and they start to behave more like the Chinese, but at the same time they still retain their non-Chinese ways. So you see a very unique state, a very unique kingdom where they try to merge two different populations, the Chinese population and the non-Chinese population, but nobody got the right formula so far to do it. During the Eastern Jing and the 16 Kingdom period, the 16 kingdoms were all very short kingdoms. They probably lasted only two generations. The king, the emperor, the king, passed to his crown prince, and that's it, gone. They are very short-lived. But for Northern Wei, it's quite unique because they were quite stable. Okay? And when it comes to Northern and Southern dynasties, historians tend to study Northern Wei because of its remarkable achievement. It has lasted for quite some time and is very stable. So this might have to do with its policy or the way it's ruled. And we're going to find out why is it that Northern Wei is more powerful and more stable than the other states. Northern Wei is established by this group of non-Chinese called the Huoba Xianbei. Right? And they were actually initially outside of China proper. They were quite different. I mentioned earlier on that the 16 Kingdom state were established by nomadic tribes who were already staying in China for quite some time and they are partially Chinese. This group of people, they were all along in the steppes of Mongolia. They were not in China proper. Where it was like, oh, okay, the Huoba Xianbei, they were not settling in China proper initially. They were from the steppes of Mongolia. They saw the opportunity, the Chinese states were, no, the northern states were fighting against each other, there was opportunity, and they started an invasion. Managed to wipe out the northern kingdoms one by one and unify them into a unified state, which we call Northern Wei. Initially, the Northern Wei kingdom established a capital that is quite far away from China proper. It's quite close to the northern border known as modern day city Dahong. It's quite far in the north. Why is that so? Because if anything happens, they can still run home. Okay? Yes, for that strategic purpose. And also because I would think climate reasons. The more you settle into inner China proper, the climate changes and people cannot take it. I will just share my own personal experience. I'm a Singaporean. I went to China just 2 weeks ago to Luoyang. Okay, Luoyang is an ancient capital of China. When I was there, the air was so dry. Here, our air is very moist. So when you are standing indoor, you start to sweat. Over there, you don't sweat. Okay, but the air is so dry that when I was opening a door, my skin cracked and I started bleeding. It was that bad. Okay, yes. So climate changes, climate differences, you might think is a very small thing, but for you to live there, it's gonna be a factor. It's gonna affect your life. Alright, so I say, I'm not gonna stay in China, I better come back to Singapore. Okay, so I believed for the four past century, these are some of the challenges they will experience when they come to China. The atmosphere is different. China actually is more wet compared to Mongolia. Mongolia is very dry. Right, it's a lot of it is desert and you can't really grow crops over there. So settling in China has its challenges for this foreign group of people. But anyway, the Huoba Xianbei is still attracted to China. They led the invasion, they tried to control China. But for this government to work successfully, they have to use the system already in place then. And the strategy they came up with is to attract, to try to attract the Chinese officials in China. In other words, the strategy they used is to use the Chinese way to rule the Chinese people. It's the most practical way at that point of time because the Tuoba Xinbei is a minority. So how are you going to enforce people to rule, to live under your kind of rule? Because laws, the culture, way of living is different. So the Chinese people is not going to be very happy if this group of people use their own laws to govern them. The most practical and pragmatic way is to use the Chinese to rule like the Chinese. And one particular ruling figure who is quite well known for this is this Empress Dowager Feng. Okay, she's quite well known for doing a lot of radical changes and reforms to absorb Chinese officials into the government. Another interesting emperor is the emperor that we are discussing today, this Gao Tu. Right? Gao Tu decided to move the capital from Dapeng to Luoyang. And he did it in a very interesting way. Actually, a lot of officials didn't agree with his shifting. So he used another way. He used an indirect way. He gathered his officials and his generals and he said, "I want to attack the south. Let's lead the army campaign and attack the south." So when they were marching, the generals, they voiced their concern. They said, "Oh, we are so far in the north. How are we going to invade all the way to the south? That's impossible. So can we not do it?" And the emperor said, "Okay, let's not do it. Let's settle down in Luoyang, since we are near Luoyang." Okay? That was how he did it in a brilliant way. Because he knows that he said to his officials directly that he wants to relocate, they are going to oppose him. So he used this way. So Gao Tu is also very well known for being pro-Chinese in many ways. One of the things he did was that he forced his Tuoba Xinbei people to speak Chinese, to pick up Chinese surnames, to wear Chinese clothes, everything Chinese. So his son was very pissed off with him. So there was this account that his son really disliked what his father did. So his son purposely, in retaliation of his father, wear back the Xianbei costume. Alright, and there was even the account where he tried to run away from Luoyang to go back to Dapeng. And his father was very angry, his father caught him and he punished him. So you can see that even though there are benefits in being more pro-Chinese for the government, a lot of the people are still not used to that style of life. They still want to retain their own lifestyle or their own culture. You can see this conflict and the dilemma of the ruling family when they want to take any pro-Chinese approach. So for Gao Tu's imperial edict, during one point of time in the mid-490s, Gao Tu released a series of edicts, which means policies. Alright, he wanted to implement some policy changes. So in this document, he has covered quite a number of topics, including how we should select people for officialdom, taking up Chinese surnames, what kind of people you can marry or what kind of people you cannot marry, the use of Chinese clothes and language at the imperial court. This, at a superficial level, looks like Gao Tu is just being pro-Chinese, wants to be more Chinese-like. But what are his true motivations, or is there other underlying meaning to this approach? Let's look at the ruling class during the early Northern Wei period. When we talk about early Wei, we are talking about the period before Gao Tu. We are doing a comparison so we know what were some of the changes that Gao Tu made that were different from his predecessor? Or did he remain constant with what his predecessors were trying to do? Or was there a shift in the policy that he implemented? When we look at Northern and Southern dynasty studies, a lot of Chinese history books will say that this is a period of time where the foreign rulers don't know how to rule China. So they have to rely on Chinese people to rule back China. But is that true? Generally speaking, yes, that is true. But when you carve out distinctive periods, or you only study one particular kingdom, you find that this is not true. So these studies actually show that for early Northern Wei, there is no inclination towards using Chinese officials. But that is not to say this period is not the period where the non-Chinese rulers relied on Chinese officials. Yes, they do. But that is an overall trend. When we start to break it down, you see some trends or some phenomena that does not follow the general trend. This is one. Okay? And to truly appreciate the statistics, we have to know what is the context and the background of it. So we are going to study three different periods, okay? One will be Gaozu itself, and the two other will be on his predecessors. And even for Gaozu's period, there's also some thing that you need to take note of so that you truly understand the figures. So during Gaozu's time, even though he was already an emperor, he came to the throne as a child. So you cannot say that for the early part of Gaozu's rule, these policies were directly implemented by himself. No, that is not so, because he was too young. So there is still a person at the back who is pushing for these policies. And for a large period of time, as you can see, when he came as a child, his father was still much in control. And when his father passed away, poor guy, his mother is the one who is in control. Alright, so if you look at it closely, only the later periods of his time that you can say that those policies were drafted by him, or his policies come from him. So, earlier periods, you have to discount the fact. No, these are not policies that is influenced by him at all, but by external factors. So we have to be careful. Alright, we are going to look at statistics in this manner as a result. So we are going to look at Xian Zhu's time, 465 to 476. And then the Empress Dowager's time, 477 to 490. And then this is the true period where we can see Gao Zu's influence, post 490. And today's study is very different from my previous study. Previously, my lecture is more of storytelling. Okay, I talk about what happened, who did this, what did that. Okay, today is very mathematical. We are going to look at statistics. And it's very fascinating to me because I never thought that you can use statistics to look at ancient China history. And I take my hat off to this person who compiled the statistics. Alright, let's look at the stats. Hey, this looks like your census. Alright, so this is the Gaozu's period, this is his father, this is his mother's. Alright, let's look at the breakdown. So we are going to explore first whether is it true that Chinese rule, there are more Chinese officials than non-Chinese officials during this period of time. When we look at it, so you can see, looks like there is slightly more. And but here, over here, what happened? Non-Chinese, there is more non-Chinese now. Then here, a difference of two. It looks like 50-50, yeah? Okay, then overall, if you compile this together and you do an average, it is like a 44 to 48%, and then a 52 to 56% for non-Han. Okay, so who is dominating? long time if you look to an average for this 3 period. But then, of course, if you break down, then you see it is not like that. That's why it is important to understand what is the significance of this period. What is the significance of this period? So we can say that there's a shift in selection policy in the sense that earlier on, you can say that there is a slight preference to Chinese. Then during Empress Dowager Feng's time, she started to prefer non-Chinese. And then when it comes to the son's time, he likes both as well. So what is the reason behind this? Is there some motivation or is there some context to why this happened? Okay. Before we go into that, we are also going to break down further because here is an overall figure of the number of titles. Because even for titles, there are differences between a more higher authority title and a lower authority title. And so it makes more sense if you break down and see who are actually the ones taking up the higher positions and who are the ones who are taking the lower positions, and the results is quite remarkable. For the purpose of this study, the author decided to classify a certain number of official titles according to his own ranking numbers. This is not the official ranking numbers, but his own way of doing it. The smaller the number, the higher, the more influential the title it is. Right, so for office 1 to 3, for this author, he's covering on positions such as Department of State Affairs and also the executive department that turned policy into practice. Alright? And it seems to be a trend that such office titles usually are reserved by the Crown Prince. So what is the next one? 4. 4 would be Board of Personnel. Alright, this division or this official is responsible for controlling appointment to office and palace affairs, like your HR. Alright? But this HR a bit useless because this HR only for lower ranking officers. For the higher ranking officer, it's still the emperor who makes the decision. Alright, office 5, quite important also, is responsible for the emperor's guard. In other words, this office number 5, you can say in more military, in a sense, control the palace army. So he's responsible for the safety and welfare of the emperor. So the emperor must make good friends with this guy. If not want this guy not happy, then he tell the guard to kill the emperor. Okay, office number 5 also very influential. 6 to 7, these positions are more like secretarial positions. So what are they supposed to do? Paperwork. They are like clerical work, responsible for preparing and drafting imperial documents. Minutes writing, maybe. Alright, they are playing the role of a clerk, so this is not so important, but still quite important because they are dealing with all the important documents. Alright, they are just writing. Their role is more of like writing and drafting documents, but they don't really have much say in the policy making. So for the early times, they are quite insignificant, but later on, because they are dealing with important documents, maybe they just change one word and change the whole sentence to favor themselves, you also never know. So later on, they become more important, alright? But that is later on, but not within today's study. So we will see this office as low-ranking office for today's study. Alright, then when you break down into office 1 to 7, then you will see a pattern. Alright, we shall look at the earlier times. Okay, this is the Emperor Gao Zu's father's time. Alright, if you look at that, where are the Chinese, what are the Chinese people doing? Low rank. Yes, 25 to 27 of them are clerks. Okay. statistics actually no meaning really, even though more Chinese are, but this Chinese what they're doing, doing paperwork, okay? So they are not important. The government, who are the ones who are holding the higher office is only three titles only. Okay, that's quite rare. Okay, three titles goes to non-Chinese and 2-0 for Chinese. Okay, most of them are here. Alright, even for here you can also see for higher position tends to favor the non-Chinese also. Okay? Here yeah, you can see this trend as well. Even for Feng's time, okay, it's the Chinese first need to dominate at the rank seven. But the non-Chinese were taking up the more important positions. Okay? So is it right to say that the Chinese officials are ruling in the northern base imperial court? No, it is still the non-Chinese people. This is quite an important finding. Alright, so why you need 25 Chinese people to be club? Why non-Han Chinese cannot be club?
Yeah, Chinese not so good, but Chinese
not. Maybe.
Like
our library, like all other non-Chinese states, they were actively trying to recruit the Chinese officials because they are the ones who know how to do their job. Okay, the non-Han people just come in not too long ago. You ask him how to take care of taxes, how to make sure the crop is well cultivated. I don't think he knows. You still need the people who are on the job to do the job. So these are the people on the ground. Okay? So a conclusion is that when you look at the statistics, the non-Han Chinese were the ones who were clearly favored for the high ranking positions. But in this case, it's not honorific, and it's also decision making posts. Okay. So this is a deviation from what we usually think. It's not Chinese people are doing that, they just take the high position and don't do nothing. But in this case, they are actually doing the decision making. This is a deviation from how we see such trends. Alright, so what kind of Chinese is favored for taking up official titles? And when you look at the pathetic few people who managed to make it through to rank 1 to 4, pathetic few. Remember, I showed you 20 plus is 7, rank 7. Only a few managed to go to rank 1 to 4. These tend to be people from places like Pingshan and Shanxi. And who are these people? They are actually people who betrayed their state earlier on. They are defectors and refugees, all refugees from other states. Alright? And also, eunuchs also managed to make it through, and also men who had marriage ties with the emperor or the royal family. Okay, so this is the kind of people who make it into office 1 to 4. We can make a statement here to say that all those people who make it to 1 and 4 are those people who are not threatening to the emperor. That's the conclusion here. Okay, those two powerful ones, I make him a club. Actually, that's what's ongoing, okay? Yes. Because these people are office 1 to 4, never mind, give him a high rank, he cannot make trouble. He has no backing. Like for the case of the refugees, they come here by themselves, they don't have a clan to support them, they don't have strong economic power or military power. They want to create trouble for the emperor, also cannot. It's the emperor. The selection policy here is very interesting. It's very pragmatic and rational. Alright? And the other group of people who make it through is those who came to power by marrying to the imperial family. So if you got married, you are one of the son-in-law, you are my family, so I can trust you. So they give high ranks to these people. Alright, these are some small minor assumptions. Sometimes, okay, you have closely related to the family, but they still get through, but it's under small exceptions. So for 6 to 7, the low-ranking officers, the pattern and the trend discovered is that these are the very powerful people. These are the people who have been in China, in that particular area, for many generations. They have a lot of backing. People support them. They have experience in the previous government. They have strong economic power base. These are the dangerous people. I want to keep them in my government so I can still check them. But I'm not going to give them high ranking office. I'm going to give them low ranking office so they don't stir trouble for me. So these are the kind of people who end up in 6 and 7. That is the funny thing. These are the powerful people. These are the powerful families, but they end up getting low ranking titles. Compared to this Chinese who hold office 1 to 4, Chinese who holds offices 6 to 7 are the ones with relatively higher social and economic status. Which explains why you have 26 to 27 people there at rank number 7.